swimmer once confided that as a boy, he had to learn to swim and swim well, but was still afraid to jump into the water over his head. His brain told him that he would quickly return to the surface, and from there he could easily swim to shallow water or to the side of the pool. But his gut told him, "You might drown before you come up to the surface. That's a horrible way to die." It was over 2 years before he trusted enough to jump into the deep end of the pool. Even after he survived the first plunge into the deep end, the next few plunges were scary acts of trust. In today's gospel, Mary's "May it be done to me" was not a line. Was not a line that she was even given to speak. It was a plunge into the very deep water, trusting that God would see her through. Over the past few weeks, we've heard of the contribution St. John the Baptist made in the run-up to Christ appearing. He has prepared the way of the Lord and publicly declared the Lamb of God who is in their midst. As we get closer and closer to the great celebration of the Lord's birth at Christmas, today we are brought to the very moment of the incarnation, the moment on which the entirety of human history turns, the moment the Son of God, the Word, the Logos, was made flesh. So what happened? Art, music, and drama have all tried to get a handle on this moment. Countless renditions of the Ave Maria, the Hail Mary, have been penned and sung over the years. There's hardly a major art gallery in the world that doesn't have a painting of Our Lady in quiet prayer as the angel Gabriel calls to chat. Sentiment, beauty, and peace are the hallmarks of these interpretations of the Annunciation. But is it so? Is that all there is to the moment of Emmanuel, God with us? Or like any other acts of creation, was this moment not a volcanic eruption of God's grace into our world? It was indeed. Sometimes we sanitize the story of our faith to such an extent that the power of what actually happens can be diminished. The shed of Bethlehem becomes a stable. The animals are reduced to a glorified central heating system, negating the fact that the Lord God Almighty was born in a barn. So too with the Annunciation. Do we notice how supremely alone Mary is? She gives her consent, and the angel Gabriel leaves. That's how the gospel story ends. As we heard, "And the angel departed from her." She has received the most important news ever. She is to be the mother of God. To start with, she is a teenage mother with all the consequences that go with that. But the mother of God? How could anyone take that in? Could we not even dare to say, "This is unfair of God"? That this is a tall order is certainly an understatement. At least let the angel Gabriel stay. But wait a minute. Let's reflect carefully about what has just happened. Mary is not alone. She was never alone. And no matter what is going to take place in the years and months ahead, she is not going to walk forsaken. The power of the Most High is upon her. He, just as on Sinai, will cover her with his shadow. But this time, God does not leave his presence in the form of the Mosaic law on stone, but in flesh, as the baby in the womb. Yes, the angel leaves, but who has come? God himself in her very body. Sometimes it's easy for us to feel alone, to feel that no one cares. In a world that is connected like never before by means of technology, communication, and social media, there is an epidemic of loneliness. 300 friends on Facebook, but no one to talk to. Even when we gather here at Mass, it's easy to feel alone. The solitary confinement of the modern era, especially during the COVID pandemic, can be a persuasive force, shutting down authentic community and human contact. If we have faith and hope in Jesus Christ, we believe that we are never alone. For by the mystery of the Incarnation, God has united himself intimately with his children. As members of the church, we are united with each other by bonds even greater than flesh and blood. This is what we declare when we recite the creed every Sunday. So as we enter into the Christmas season, we can get sucked into the trap of the perfect Christmas, where everyone is happy, well-dressed, and fed. Just like all the commercials or Hallmark Channel Christmas movies we see on TV. However, for many, it is a lonely and hard time. Families are not perfect. Our lives are not perfect. Pursuing the perfection of the world proposes can leave us sad and profoundly lonely. Advent is our time to ponder the promise that God is among us, that the Word of God made flesh, Jesus Christ, is asking our consent to become flesh in our lives. The Incarnation is not just a one-time event, but an ongoing invitation to welcome God into our lives. As baptized members of the body of Christ, filled with the Holy Spirit, and nourished by both Word and Eucharist, are we not God-bearers, temples of the Trinity, extensions of the presence of God in space and time? Mary invites us to share in the mystery she carried and bore in her human life. The church invites us to say yes to the same overshadowing of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost that gave birth to the church, extending the life and mission of Jesus in history. The Annunciation reminds us that when we say yes to God, that we are never alone, even in the most seemingly difficult circumstances. Now is the time to rehearse our own yes to God by imitating Mary's faithfulness and obedience to God's plan. Perhaps we could consciously think of our holiday greeting to others as a way to make generosity and joy concrete. Perhaps we could take a few minutes out of our busy days to listen for God's word. Say yes, and then put God's message into action. In flesh, God's presence in the goodness of our own lives. My friends, on this last day of Advent, like Mary, let us take the plunge to renew our own commitment by saying yes to God's call and offer of salvation. Praise be the Sacred Heart of Jesus, now and forever. Amen.